Is Bollywood trying to divide India? Does Padmaavat invoke narratives that are Islamophobic, homophobic and gender biased? Think about Fiza, Mission Kashmir and Sarfarosh. What's the common factor? A Muslim who's a terrorist. The Uttar Pradesh government omitted Taj Mahal from its tourism brochure. It was seen as India's move to wipe out its Mughal history. Many Bollywood movies depict Muslims as one homogeneous group, but surely that isn't India's reality. So, in this context, should a filmmaker be particularly cautious about distorting history?
A lot of people have written historical fiction and then they have been taken as actual truth.
In the movie, Alauddin Khilji and Ratan Singh fight over the conquest of a territory.
History is being rewritten every day, whether it is in books, in comics, or because, see, the normal person today does not read. We are in the age of Twitter. We read 140. There are so many people who are even protesting 280. Why have you made it 280? Because even that's difficult to read. So we are in the age of 140 characters. We definitely do not want to read books. Seeing videos and consuming movies is far easier. So the visual medium is the medium which is the most successful and which has the biggest reach. So we, the filmmakers and people who make videos, have a lot of responsibility for that. That they should not show anything which is so completely distorts history. Like somewhere in this movie, I felt, and that's what has been, you know, like talked about also by many people, that they've shown a clash of civilization. You know, like on one side there's a barbarian king, on the other side there is a king who's, you know, full of principles and who's doing everything just correctly and very picture perfect. Now there's no doubt, I'm sure the king of Chittor may have been picture perfect and full, very principled and everything there. I'm not disputing that. But it doesn't mean that because the hero is so perfect, the villain has to be just as dark. So that, and because they both belong to different religions, so that sets up a clash of civilizations. Which is not what Jayasi definitely wanted, because his book starts with Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and during the book he talks of Kailash, he talks of Mansarovar, he also says that the world has been made for Muhammad by Allah, because Muhammad is the Noor. So, you know, like he has beautifully combined everything, because he was a Sufi and Chishti Sufis were very influenced by the Nath Panthis.
When we present one-dimensional characters from specific communities, are we reinforcing the negative stereotypes that we already have?
I think he's missed the point, entire point of Padmavati, of the, at least the poem Padmaavat. He's missed the entire point, which is the poem Padmaavat is a fight between Ishq-e Haqiqi, which is divine love, and nafs, ego. So Alauddin represents ego or the nafs or lust, and Ratan Singh represents Ishq-e Haqiqi or love for the divine. So that is the fight that should have been shown, but somehow Alauddin has become an over-the-top villain who is only lusty and nothing else. And instead of being, you know, like very spiritual, Ratan Sen comes across as a very one-dimensional character. Alauddin Khilji was a tyrant, there is no doubt about it. In Delhi, if you go to Hoskhas area, you will see that Chor Minar, which is where he used to hang the heads of the people who were thieves. They would be hung there on the spikes over there as a warning for people. There's no doubt he was cruel and a tyrant, but he was not a barbarian. He was in fact a very astute administrator, and his agrarian and land reforms and market reforms have been followed by many. In fact, his land reforms were also followed by Akbar and Sher Shah, because he cut off the intermediary between the cultivator and the state and took direct tax from them. So he reduced the burden on them, as well as increased taxation, because he needed to maintain an army. And all these things were because he needed to defend his borders and strengthen the army. The Mongols were standing just at the doorstep of the Delhi Sultanate, and they had already devastated most of Central Asia. In fact, Baghdad, all these places had been, Samarkand, all these places had been destroyed by the Mongol hordes. And it's under Alauddin Khilji, because he kept Delhi safe, that art and culture flourished, men of learning came here, and Delhi in fact started to be called the Baghdad of the East.
Bhansali did keep one part of Alauddin Khilji accurate. He acknowledged his bisexuality, but his portrayal of bisexuality has been criticized. Sure, Bollywood has been praised for the portrayal of the LGBTQ communities in the movies like Aligarh, Kapoor and Sons and Fire. But Bollywood has a long way to go. Padmaavat is the latest movie that doesn't go beyond stereotypes.
He's already shown the relationship, so what is there not to show? In fact, he should have shown it sensitively. He did not show it sensitively, because Malik Kafur is only shown as a very, you know, lovesick kind of a buffoon. He was a very famous and a very successful general. The entire Deccan campaign and the campaign against the Mongols was handled by Malik Kafur for Alauddin Khilji. So they should have shown that dimension of him also. They just showed a caricature of him. See, bisexuality was very common in the medieval ages. And in fact, there's a whole genre of poetry called Sheher-e-Ashob, which later on in the 18th century became Lament of a City. But before that, it was called the City Disturber. And it was about these young Turkish boys who are offering their wares to poets. So it very coquettishly. So it was, you know, like never frowned upon. There's a whole lot of, there's a whole genre of love poetry written men for men. So it was not. In this movie, what is wrong is the way Bhansali has showed it. He's showed it in a very negative way. He has not shown the relationship between Malik Kafur and between Alauddin Khilji in a very positive way. So that, I think, is the complaint. People are saying it's a homophobic film.
So, when will Bollywood start giving us more complex characters on a regular basis? A study by IBM and two Delhi-based institutions found that over a period of 50 years in Bollywood, heartbroken, stage dancer, beautiful young girls are the most common attributes given to the female actor. The movie Padmaavat just does that. In the movie, Padmavati commits suicide to protect her honor.
See, as far as Padmavati is concerned, the disclaimer at the beginning of the movie itself says that it is loosely based on the epic poem by Malik Muhaamed Jayasi called Padmavat. Now, Malik Muhaamed Jayasi himself took a lot of liberties with history and geography because he wanted to write a Sufi romance, which was in fashion those days. He wrote it in Avadhi, which was a dialect of UP where he lived. He lived in the Sultanpur district. So he took many liberties so that he could fit in everything. Now, Padmavati, the name, because he wanted to show a lotus maiden who is supposed to be perfect, was the name of Rana Sanga's wife we hear. Because that's a name that is mentioned, that only mention that we, the only mention to a Padmavati that we get in medieval sources is in Babar Nama, where Babar says that the wife of Rana Sanga is Padmavati, who was the king of Mewar. So maybe he took the name from there. Now, Amir Khusro in Khazanul Futu, where he describes the conquest of Chittor, does not mention any name of a king. He just says Rai, which means king. But the ruler of Chittor at the time when Jayasi was writing was named Ratan Sen. So maybe he took the name Ratan Sen from there. Now, Chittor, the word was used because Chit means heart and Aur means body. So he took it to symbolize body. Now, like that, he's taken various names and things from and incidents from various places.
So, given that Bhansali had such a complex story to work with, wasn't it his responsibility to give us a more complex story? Tell us in the comment section.